end as we start our service with singing This Is Amazing Grace. So I just wanted to remind us of why we gather together in church. We gather together to remind each other of the good news that Jesus died for our sins, that he rose for our life, and that he is coming again as king to rule and reign in all of creation. And we come together to remind ourselves that that is the reality that we live in. That's why we sing songs to Jesus, but also for ourselves to remind us of the truth. And that's why we week by week listen to God's word declared to us in the Bible. So I want to invite you to join as we sing together. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Brings our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
This next song is a new song. It's called Grace Alone. We're going to sing it now and then I'll sing it at the end again so that you guys can learn it. But it basically tells our story of who we are before God found us and what he's done and his love for us, his everlasting love for us that was before creation, before all the world began, that he poured out his love on us through Jesus. So...
I was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I'd hear you call. Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own. I had no right to draw near your throne. Father, you loved me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. You left your home to seek out the lost. You grew at a great and terrible cost. Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to the bone. Nothing I did could ever atone. Jesus, you paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. A head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. Spirit, you moved in me. At your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Caught into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven said, ascend by grace and grace alone. So I'll stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run the race by grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone.
Please be seated, everybody. Welcome to church this evening, and welcome to all you young guys. Thanks for coming and supporting us. Wonderful. I hope you... enjoying being back at school. I know you love school. Am I right? Yep. So let me just ask, what happened on Friday? What did you do at youth?
Smash our face in a cake.
Oh, you did that cake thing where you eat all the cake and you get covered in flour and all of that, and then you clean the whole church up. I love that. That's a wonderful Friday night. And what's up for next week? Tell me, come on. The Amazing Race. I'm excited. All right. So have you invited any friends to next Friday?
I think so.
Come on, you guys have to invite somebody. Remember, you've got to share it. If it's lovely, you got to share it with others. Amazing Grace. So good to have you all here tonight. Tonight we're going to hear Harry share some crazy stories. Is it about cats and dogs, Harry? Not, eh? About relationships. Well, you've got all of our attentions right now, Harry, because many of us are looking for somebody. Many of us think we've already found somebody, and others are praying desperately for somebody. So we're excited to hear about that, Harry. Just a few announcements. There's a ladies' event this coming Saturday, so if you're a lady or a young lady, please, we'd love you to attend. Please, if you can just give me your name after the service, that'd be wonderful. And the other announcement was that, I can't remember right now. Oh, that the tithes and offerings box is over there. So if you want to put your tithes and offerings, you can do it inside there. But once again, let me say, I did not have the privilege of welcoming Julie because I was away. But Julie, welcome again. Lovely to have you. Julie Christensen. Nice name. We got Christian and Christensen, so that's good. We're getting somewhere in this church, so that's good. I was away this past week. I was on a pastor's retreat, and I had the wonderful opportunity of being able to share with some pastors and talk about them. We also did a bit of fishing. I know you guys don't like fishing, am I right? So we did some fishing, we did some four-wheel driving, which was great, and we had a good time, but we chatted, and it was lovely just to chat with some other pastors about the ministry, so that was really great. There are a few of our people in our church who are struggling in hospital at the moment, so if any of you know, our friend Henk, he's in Caboolture, but he's going to be moved to Prince Charles, and it looks like they're going to maybe put a pacemaker in his heart. So pray for him. Pray for Johan, who's recovering from back surgery. He had a disc replaced in his back, which is very, very painful. And then also pray for Roy Hewitt, who also had some stents put in his heart. So these are big operations, so we pray for those people that are going through that. So I'm going to just pray for us, pray for the church, pray for our youth, pray for our kiddies, and pray for our families, all right? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for everything that you give us. You're an amazing and wonderful God. We think of what we have. We have mums and dads, and we have family, and we have all that surrounds us. We thank you that in Queensland, things are quite okay with the virus, but we pray for Melbourne and Sydney and those places that are really struggling, God, and we pray that you'd be with all those that are sick and that your grace and mercy would be upon them. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would help us find a vaccine for this very terrible disease. We also pray, Lord, that you'd be with Talia, and Jerry and Jordan and Caleb and Julie and all of those that help with the youth and the kids. I pray that you just bless them, give them everything they need to serve you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for them. Thank you for the gift that they are to us, and pray that you would just bless them, Lord. We pray for our kids and for our youth that you'd also protect them, Lord. This world can be very cruel towards kids and youth. There's so many people out there who would love to destroy their lives, but we pray that you would protect them. And then we pray that tonight, as we learn about relationships, that you would speak to us, that you'd open our eyes, our ears, and our hearts to hear from you tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Can I get you to come up and do the Bible reading before we do our song before Harry gets up?
Okay, I'm reading from Psalm 119, verses 9 to 16. How can a young person stay pure? By obeying your word. I have tried hard to find you. Don't let me wander from your commandments. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I praise you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. I have recited aloud all the regulations you have given us. I have rejoiced in your laws as much as in riches. I will study your commandments and reflect on your ways. I will delight in your decrees and not forget your word.
I invite you to stand as we sing our next song.
And I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. I've heard the tender whisper of love. In the dead of night you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your way. You are perfect in all of your way. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Yes, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to undeniable. I can hardly speak in peace, so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this night. We thank you that we can come together and hear your word. Lord, I pray that you would empower Harry as he comes to speak, and that he would be able to open the scriptures to us, but also help us to be transformed by them and encounter Jesus tonight. In Jesus' name.
Harry, I really like that last song very well. Okay, am I using one of these? Yes. Cool. Thank you. All right. Teaching here. So yeah, I'm really excited to be up here to preach to you guys again. But before I begin, I want to introduce you to Facebook Messenger. It's on my phone, and I can also find her on my laptop. Now, I was homeschooled on a farm for most of my life, and my friends lived a long way away. We couldn't see each other much, and because phone calls are a bit awkward with our generation, we tended to prefer Facebook Messenger as our main communication. Now, the reason I brought it up was because it features heavily in my life in the field of relationships. So, warning, you might find this to be a bit awkward. All right. So, I'm still single at 25 years of age, but I've had my share of romance, and on two occasions, I've actually had a girlfriend. I had one when I was 21 and one just last year. Now, both relationships were long distance, and because of this, we often could only see each other once a month. So imagine that you're not living just next door or a few streets away or 3 hours, 6 hours, it was a fair bit. So most of our relationship was done over Messenger. Now, this is my illustration because much in the same way, due to the great rift that came at Adam's fall, we have been stuck in a long distance relationship with God, unable to reach God face to face. And so he has used his own messenger system, which is a series of angels, earthly prophets, and scribes. And he did come once visiting us in person as Jesus. And while here, he left many messages behind with his faithful disciples. Now, all these messages have been compiled into what we now know as the Bible. This book is God's primary way of reaching out to us, the people that he loves. He uses this book to build a relationship with us, to tell us about himself, and especially to show us how to find the way back to him once again. But sadly for God, his messages are often being ignored or overlooked. So today I have chosen one of these messages to share with you. And the reason I chose this particular message is because it teaches us all about the other messages and what we're supposed to do with them. God sent this message through a psalmist. Now, a psalmist is a Jewish poet or a songwriter. We don't know this person, this guy by name, but he clearly loved to read God's word, and he wrote for us a huge poem all about God's wonderful word. It's called Psalm 119. Now, this huge psalm is an acrostic poem, which is an alphabetic poem. For each letter of the Hebrew alphabet, we get a set of 8 verses that all start with that letter. At least they did in Hebrew. In English, it's been translated, so they don't anymore. So the 8 verses I'm reading are from their letter Beth, which is kind of our equivalent of the letter B. So if it was in our language, it would be like they all start, each verse started with the letter B. All right, so let's begin. You'll find after reading the rest of the verses that this first one is quite different. The others are full of emotion and are about the psalmist talking to God. But this one is simply a basic instruction. It's verse 9. How can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word. Now, if we try to live a life that is pure and holy to God, we will only fail. We just don't know how to live such a life, which is why we need God's word. God's word contains everything we need to know about returning to God again. We find his word described as a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. That's actually later in this same psalm. And Jesus himself is described as the Word become flesh. He is the way to God. God sent his Word to guide us. And if we want to find God, we must live by his Word. Now, for most of us, it might make us feel guilty or even discouraged to hear this verse. I, for one, tried many times to live by the Word of God. I tried Bible reading plans. I tried scheduling my time. I tried memorizing passages of Scripture. But after each surge of self-discipline wore off, the habits would never stick. I'd fall behind in the reading plan. I'd forget what I'd just read in the Bible. My memory would fade, and eventually life would get too busy, resulting in God's Word falling by the wayside. Now, I felt really bad about this. I knew a Christian was supposed to love God and his Word, but I found it tedious and uninteresting. I was very aware of my lack of emotional devotion to God and even began to doubt whether I really was a Christian. This scared me because I wanted to be a Christian. I wanted to go to heaven. I wanted to be saved from hell. Well, thankfully for me, this psalmist doesn't stop with that cold statement of fact. After affirming that living by the Word is the only way to God, the psalmist starts to talk about his own journey with the Word of God. And when reading it, we can clearly see that this unnamed man is deeply attached to God and his Word at an emotional, even almost a romantic level. The psalmist jumps back and forth between describing his emotional connection to God's Word and his devoted study of the Word. All the even-numbered verses in the psalm, 10, 12, 14, 16, describe the emotions, and the odd-numbered ones, 11, 13, and 15, describe the devoted study. I think the reason it looks like this is because this psalmist wears his emotions on his sleeve. For example, if I said everything I felt while talking to my girlfriend, I'd keep cutting in on our get-to-know-you conversations with things like, "Oh boy, I really like talking to you," or "I really like your laugh." I keep jumping between learning something about her and admiring something about her. And that's what this psalmist is doing. So to begin this section, I'm going to look at verses 10 and verse 12. The first two emotional verses. Oh, very good. The study's up. All right, so verse 10. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. This desperate cry from the psalmist is probably the one I relate to the most. When I was finding the Bible boring and tedious, I also felt really out of touch with God. All my prayers and emotions felt dead, but there were two things I did have that still gave me hope that I was in the right place, and they were desire and fear. The first was desire. I desired more than anything to know and be loved by God. And even though I didn't feel loved or known, the fact that it was what I wanted was very telling. Because no child of the devil wants to be loved by God. They want to be their own God and live life their own way. The second is fear. I believed everything about God that included his power. It also included hell or an eternity without God in torment. And that made me scared. The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. No child of the devil fears God. They scoff him, they ignore him, and pretend that he doesn't matter at all. They have no fear of God, but I certainly did. If I thought that there was even a chance that I would end up on his bad side, I wanted to be absolutely sure I was on the right side. So back to the verses again. Verse 12. Praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. In this verse, the psalmist has paused briefly from simply praising God to simply praising God. Time set aside to hang out with someone you love is vital for the health of any relationship, especially with God. If you pause long enough from life's busyness and take a walk in nature or sit in a quiet place or even come to a worship service, you might find a sweet spot where you can quiet your soul and simply reflect on who God is, and you might find that personal connection you long for. This, by the way, is especially important at the start of a relationship, and I'll explain with a story. There was a time when I was in a state of emotional turmoil trying to decide whether a certain girl that I liked felt the same way about me. I was trying to read the vibe she was giving and would ask my sister about whether they thought she liked me or was just being nice. I even asked a friend of hers, who was also a friend of mine, "Do you think this girl likes me?" Now, that friend gave me simple but good advice. "Look, if you want to know whether she likes you or not, you should go ask her yourself." Okay, so I did. And guess what? She didn't like me that same way. However, she appreciated that I had been open and honest with her, and our friendship actually deepened as a result. It's the same way with God. When we are faced with doubts as to whether we are in a right relationship with God, we can worry, we can ask other people's opinions, we can try reading our emotions, or we can go to God himself. Pray to God and ask him whatever you want, and then open up his word and seek his answer. From there, it's a journey between you and him. So, and that journey is my second point. The psalmist, he is now on his journey with God and his word. And this is where I would like us to look at all the odd-numbered verses. There are three of them. And these are where the psalmist is studying God's word. And one thing we can quickly realize is that this psalmist is doing a lot more than simply reading it. In verse 11, he says, "I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." Now, hiding it in your heart is a figure of speech. And at first, I thought of it as meaning memorizing the word. But that's more about getting it into your head. So when I'm doing a geography test and have to memorize the states of America, for example, I will normally treat that as head knowledge. But if I'm in a relationship and a girl I like tells me things like her birthday or her favorite restaurant, I'm not just going to put those in my head. I'm going to take them to heart and remember them for future reference. And with the Bible, you don't just read it, take it to heart. It pleases God when he sees us taking on board his word and doing what he asks us, because it shows that we really do care about him. Verse 13, "With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth." What do you like to talk about? I know for me, I like to talk about history. That's probably my favorite general subject. But things like sports or cars, they don't interest me as much. But when I'm in a relationship, I often want to talk about the girl that I really like or about topics that came up when she and I were talking. All her interests start to become my interests. And it's the same with God and his word. If our interest in him and his word is genuine, we will begin to find talking about God or the Bible to be topics we enjoy. And talking about the Bible also helps in other ways. We will be attracted to friends who also like talking about it. And when we help each other study the Bible, we will help each other grow in our understanding of God. And then finally, verse 15, "I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways." Meditating and considering is all about working through the stories and messages of God to try and understand his word more fully. The messenger relationship equivalent would be having the deeper, more serious conversations with your girlfriend. You explore questions like what you believe, what your plans and hopes are for the future, how to work through some personality issues you might be facing in the relationship. These conversations are vital for deepening and strengthening any relationship. Now, in my case, this is where my relationships both ended. We found that we strongly believed different things. We had hopes and dreams that didn't fit, and there were a few personality clashes that regularly caused trouble that we couldn't work through. And that's where our relationship with God is actually different to earthly relationships. God has no faults, and his hopes and dreams are perfect. Our problem is that they are often hard for us to accept because we are flawed humans. If we clash with God, then we clearly have issues. If we don't like his plans, we obviously have our priorities wrong. And that's the bright side of a relationship with God. You always know who's at fault and needs to change. It's you. So here I would like to pause and tell you some specifics about my journey with God and His Word. I chose to devote all of last year to seeking to know, understand, and love God because I knew I had problems in those areas. So I attended Cape and Ray Bible School, and one of my big moments came during what we call the Cape and Ray Adventure Week. We were given several hours to sit quietly by ourselves and simply read God's Word. I, for one, had trouble. I knew that if I opened it, I would get lost in details and lose interest. I tried a psalm, I tried a piece of a gospel, but I'd heard it before and knew nothing would stick. So I closed the Bible and I prayed, God, you know I want to love and understand you more, so please give me the inspiration I need to read and enjoy your word. So then I just sat back and started playing a game with my Bible. I really liked maths, so I started counting the page numbers and tried splitting and categorizing the Bible into smaller parts. Then I got an idea about how to read the Bible with my own Bible plan. I would choose a section of the Bible, like the law, and read through it for a few days, long enough to get some good insight, but not too long to lose interest. Then I would switch to a different section, like the prophets, and read for a few days more. I also got a notebook and promised to write down a six-line summary of what I read each day so I wouldn't forget. And guess what? It worked. In just 6 months, I had read the entire Bible. And to make it even better, from all those notes, I had unwittingly written my own summarized version of the Bible. I actually have it here with me right now. This is 30 pages long, and it was written entirely by me, and I've called it Harry's Bible Summary 2019. I've got the Bible summarized in 25 pages, in 5, and in 1. And I think for your guys' sake, I'm going to read my one paragraph summary of the Bible just to show you kind of what I was doing. Out of a wicked world, God raises up a holy nation guided by the law of Moses. This holy nation continues to disappoint through its 1,000 years of judges, kings, and exile. They accumulate many songs, essays, sayings, and stories about God, wisdom, life, etc. Prophets call for Israel's repentance, warning of judgment, but also foresee coming restoration. Then the extraordinary life and atoning work of Jesus begins to transform the world. And Christ's faithful followers, the church, write letters to teach, guide, and strengthen one another while they await his return. So that's just a short piece of my long thing here. That was me exploring the Bible for 6 months, and I really enjoyed that whole time. All right, back to my message. Finding a creative way that works for you is a great way to begin to study God's Word. Now, if you're more of a visual learner and don't like reading, you might prefer YouTube videos. There is a website called The Bible Project, where they make short videos about each book of the Bible, and even some about biblical concepts or topics. If you aren't much of a reader, you can give them a go. And no doubt there are plenty of other online resources you can access for free. But my point is there is no better time to start getting into your unread messages from God than now. Now back to my messenger relationships. After the uncertainty at the start of a relationship, you begin to clear things up as you open up about deeper and more personal subjects, and your time together grows very intimate, even over long distances. There is something incredible at having someone in your life who you can talk to about literally anything. You start to check your phone first thing in the morning to see if you've missed a message from her. You could be messaging back and forth for hours through the day. And if she sends you a long message with lots of content, it's even better than a short one. It's always a joy to read a message from someone you adore. Well, as we look at our final two even-numbered verses, they are verses 14 and 16, we can see that this is exactly how this psalmist feels about God and his holy scriptures. In verse 14, I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. When you are in the middle of a feel-good relationship, you could have nothing and yet feel like the wealthiest man alive. Why? Because there is a girl out there who says she loves you more than any other man in the world. She trusts you with her secrets and feelings. She tells you all the time how much she misses you and how wonderful you are. Her messages are your prized possession. So it is when you hit that sweet spot in your relationship with God. When you are there, his word can't be big enough. When John closes his gospel message with these words, Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. Well, guess what? I really wish those books had been written because I want to know everything I can about Jesus. I even had to go writing a biblical fan fiction once. I got 50,000 words into a book I was writing based on one of Jesus' parables. In persecuted countries, Christians would prize just one page of scripture over everything else they own. The Bible is the greatest earthly treasure we have, and anyone who owns one is very rich. And verse 16 is the last verse. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. This is more of the same idea, but with this verse, I would like to take a practical point. Failure to read the Bible isn't the cause of a struggling Christian life. It's a symptom. I'm still friends with my two ex-girlfriends, but life has moved on and we have very little reason or interest in keeping up regular communication. The reason is simply that our heart isn't in it anymore. It's like that with God. If we have no desire to read God's word, it is because our relationship with God has lost its spark. But the difference is that God hasn't moved on. He's not going anywhere, and as soon as we want to return to an intimate relationship with him again, he'll be there waiting to respond to our messages. But if we are in the midst of a blissful, long-distance romance with our Creator God, we will never neglect the reading of his word. It won't be a task. It won't be a discipline. It will be our delight. And we would never neglect reading it. For me, the Word of God is becoming this more and more. I've read the whole thing many times, but I'm now going back over it to find all the little things that I've missed. I even started Bible college so that I can dive deeper into understanding God's Word. I'm also more excited than ever to teach the Word of God to others. This is one of the reasons why I'm enjoying the internship so much. When you're in love, you wish that everyone else would be as happy as you are. And that is exactly why I'm telling all this to you now. So let us take a look back over what we have covered. First will be my typical romance over messenger. There will be a girl I can't stop thinking about, and I long to know if she likes me. After asking others their opinions and advice, I send some tentative messages her way to see if she wants to talk. And she does. Our conversations get more animated, and then finally I send that scary post. Do you like me? After some awkward silences, she shares, yes, that's what my first one said. The second girlfriend said, I'd like to find out if I do. So suddenly, the barrier is down, and we start talking about anything and everything. Yeah. We share our favorite things, our beliefs, our opinions, our hopes for the future, and what we like about each other. Before long, even trivial banter and conversations are wonderful things to hear. We are just talking to each other now because we love to hear our voices, know what's going on inside, and long to know everything we can about them. It's the sweet spot in a messenger relationship, and the only way to make it better is to actually be with them in person. So as I end this message, I would like us to look back over it and observe this psalmist's journey. He longed to know God and his word. And because of this longing, he read, studied, memorized, and talked about God's word every day, all the while writing songs to sing his praises and ask for his help or attention. And before long, the psalmist had a love and delight for God and his word that couldn't be quenched. He had reached a sweet romance in his walk with God, and the only thing left for the psalmist was to one day be face to face with God in heaven. So do you want that to be your journey with God? He will never fail me, and he will never give up on me when I fail him, so I certainly do. He's the best lover you could ever hope for. So open up that Bible, start scrolling through all those messages, and begin your own romance with God today. Thank you all. All right. Over to you again, Jerry.
Thanks, Harry. I invite you to stand as we sing our last two songs.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing. No turning back, I've been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need, Christ my all in all, my joy, my salvation. And this hope will never fail, heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here. To God be the glory. Christ is enough for me. Yes, Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in. Everything I need, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need,
Christ is enough.
Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. everything I need. Yes, I was an orphan lost at the fold, running away when I'd hear you call. Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own, I had no right to journey your throne. Father, you loved me still, and in love before you laid the world's foundation. You predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. You left your home to seek out the lost. You know the great and terrible cost. Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to the bone. Nothing I did could ever atone. Jesus, you paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. A head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. Spirit, you moved in me. Just touch, I sleep, and the spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ was shone. Caught into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven set us in by grace and grace alone. So I'll stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run the race by grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone. Oh.
Now, one of the messages that the Bible has for us, that this song is based off, it comes from the book, the letter to the Ephesians, in chapter 2, and it says, it's by grace that you've been saved through faith. This is not from you. It's not done by works. It is a gift of God. And that's what Harry's been talking about. It's internalizing that message and remembering what he has already said and what he is telling us through his messages. So as we go with that truth, go with that knowledge that God does love us. God wants us to know him in a deeper way. Thus endeth the service. Have a good week.